I think it's a fact that we are facing now the sixth great extinction. And depending on which statistics you believe, this could be the greatest one the Earth has seen. Everywhere you see around the world, habitat destruction continues apace. We don't know, the really important thing is, we don't know what this is going to do, because other extinctions have not been like this one. They haven't been wholesale removal of habitats because of the activities of one species. The previous great extinctions have been the result of often external disasters, a meteorite impact, huge desertification, but never before have we had one where one species has done for so many others.
This juniper is the image of survival. It lives alone in the middle of an infertile land while it follows the desert in its unstoppable advance. We're in the foothills of the Doñana wetlands in the south of Spain. In the bordering pine forests, the sand is invading this territory. New environmental conditions have eliminated many species. Insects, birds, and small mammals disappear since there are no trees and the water is becoming scarce. Nature, however, doesn't give in. Although limited to just a little more than these juniper branches advancing with the dunes, life continues tenaciously forward. The Earth's climate has suffered successive changes, which has determined the number and variety of species in each period. The concept of biodiversity specifically refers to the richness of life in a determined time and space. It's a calculation that measures the variety of species, keeping in mind that those species are capable of reproducing among themselves. There is little difference between insects, plants, and mammals, because every living being counts. And not only because it is alive, but because life also depends on it. The number of species that exist today is unknown. There are about 2 million classified, although no one really knows the percentage that this figure represents with respect to the total number of species inhabiting the Earth. Scientists do not agree on the approximations, because some believe that there are at least 4 million species, while others, who are more optimistic, estimate that there are more than 100 million. Between the two extremes, the most accepted figure is around 14 million different living beings. The small dark coleopterans, the common beetle, are the monarchs in the kingdom of the high figures of biodiversity. They form the most numerous group of all insects, while at the same time are the living beings most capable of proliferating on Earth. Centuries ago, the Egyptians chose the beetle as the symbol of what never dies. Today, scientific investigation confirms this intuition. The current inventory of beetles reaches a total of 350,000 species. This animal has made more variations to itself than any other species, which without a doubt is a way of guaranteeing eternity. The predominance and diversity of what is small is not a whim of nature. They correspond to a need. Without insects, the delicate machinery of life would not work. They rid the ecosystems of biological remains. They oxygenate the soil and serve as food for hundreds of species of birds, reptiles, and mammals. But most of all, they are essential for plants, whose reproduction depends almost exclusively on the millions of insects that transfer the pollen from one flower to another. As the size of the species decreases, the task it carries out becomes more important. This is the case of bacteria. With such microscopic dimensions, these organisms carry out the hardest cleaning job of recycling dead animal and plant waste, which are returned to the ecosystem as a valuable nutritious material. In more general terms, bacteria are adapted to consume chemical elements like nitrogen, phosphorus, and carbon, which are essential for many beings. This explains why large armies of bacteria invade all living areas of the planet. Just a handful of soil can hold up to 10 billion of these organisms. The contribution of bacteria was also the key in the way life was accepted on Earth. They were the trigger so that the atmosphere could begin to circulate oxygen freely. Up until that moment, no living being needed it to exist.
In the early history of the planet, there was very little free oxygen in the atmosphere. So most of the organisms, bacteria particularly, were adapted to metabolize, to grow and reproduce in the absence of oxygen. Now, at some point, certainly more than 2,500 million years ago, and possibly as much as 3,500 million years ago, the first photosynthetic bacteria, blue-green bacteria and other organisms, released oxygen into the atmosphere. Initially, of course, this would have been poison to all those creatures that were used to living in the absence of oxygen. So, if you want to put it like that, yes, originally, oxygen was a pollutant. But, of course, it became, as it gradually built up in concentration, absolutely vital, literally vital, to the evolution of animals, because animals use oxygen to breathe. So a pollutant, in one sense, became the necessity for life's further advancement.
The abundance of oxygen favors the appearance of organisms with new characteristics. During the early stages, the Earth was dominated by single-cell beings. But due to the revolution of oxygen, multicellular individuals began to spread throughout the planet. These beings caused major changes in the methods of reproduction. If the single-cell being created its descendants by duplicating itself or by dividing itself, these new organisms, on the other hand, invented sexual reproduction. Two individuals came together to produce a third, or several others, which are not the same as the parents. This jump opened the doors so that life could diversify, and from this moment forward, the Earth became enriched with contrasts. In the 19th century, Charles Darwin deduced the basic rules that explained why living beings are different and why some impose themselves on others. Essentially, the variety among species is owed to mutations and small physiological changes that originate in reproduction. Over time, when this small change is beneficial for the individual, it may accentuate and become a distinctive feature, marking a different path of evolution. Thus, bird wings could have come about as a small protuberance, which originally may have served for jumping a little higher or for moving a little faster. With time, this incipient extremity turned into such a big advantage that it ended up as a wing for flying. The survival of some species and the disappearance of others was what Darwin called natural selection. He referred to the ability of fitting into the environment that each individual had to confront with every new experiment of nature. In this way, from generation to generation, through hundreds of millions of stages and periods, the stronger living beings, or those with a stronger ability to fit into the environment, triumphed over those that could not.
I don't have much doubt that most evolution occurs by small steps. There's a very obvious reason for that. If you make a large change to an organism, it'll almost certainly be bad. If you take a hammer and you hit the engine of your motor car very hard, it's most unlikely to do it any good. Big changes are, on the whole, big changes in a thing which is already extremely complicated and very efficient are likely to be bad. But it is possible that a small fraction, anyway, of the small changes that happen, just slight changes in shape or size, will be an advantage. And I think almost all evolution happens by these small changes. Having said that, there are some changes that it's rather hard to imagine happening in a lot of small steps. When we look back on evolution, we can point to one or two things that do seem to have been fairly dramatic and sudden. I mean, you were either one cell or two. I mean, you know, you can't be one and a half cell or one and a tenth of a cell. So the origin of organisms which have many cells didn't happen very gradually.
The slow path traveled during the evolution of species is similar to a chronicle of failures. Most of the genetic variations that a species undergoes do not provide an advantage. And although the factory of biodiversity doesn't stop generating new types of species, in reality, few are able to find a place in nature. The biggest enemy of survival, however, is not found in the individual's difficulty to evolve, but in the catastrophes that, with a certain frequency, have really shaken the Earth. Like a strong blow of an axe at the tree of life, every cataclysm has provoked the sudden disappearance of most of the species that would have conquered the Earth at a certain time. The scars of dozens of environmental catastrophes are found in the geological registry. We know that five of these catastrophes produced massive extinctions. There are three in particular, however, in which biodiversity suffered major destruction. The first great extinction took place 440 million years ago, during the Ordovician period. It caused more than half the species to disappear. This was the end of the first phase of life diversification. And investigators believe that this was the consequence of an enormous freeze of the Earth's climate. 200 million years later, during the Permian period, the most deadly of all known extinctions occurred. 54% of the families and 96% of the marine species were driven out, thus destroying the biological factory of the oceans. The trilobites disappeared, just like many insects and all the coral from that time period. This extinction, however, determined a new diversity in which terra firma would become a new element. It would not be long before the dinosaurs arrived. Finally, 65 million years ago, the extinction best known to man occurred. The Cretaceous period, in which the dinosaurs disappeared, opened the way for the mammals to find the road for their diversification and mastery of the Earth. Geologists and biologists explain that most of these extinctions are due to climate changes that altered environmental conditions. The motive was occasionally the crashing of meteorites and asteroids coming from space, their impact being similar to hundreds of nuclear bombs falling on the Earth.
Well, we can think about the candidates for this biological destruction, and there are really only three or four that have been proposed seriously in recent years. In many ways, the favorite candidate of most people is a bombardment by a very large meteorite. We know that happened 65 million years ago at another time of great extinctions, the time when the dinosaurs were wiped out. On the other hand, there is only very limited and controversial evidence for any kind of meteorite impact at the end of the Permian. Other things that have been proposed are large-scale drops in the sea level, large changes in temperature. Neither one of those actually seems to solve our problems. But there's one more thing that happens at the end of the Permian that makes a lot of people think, and that is one of the largest events of, one of the largest volcanic events that we know of in the last 500 million years happens precisely at the end of the Permian, when almost the entirety of central Siberia was covered by up to a kilometer of lava. This kind of very large volcanic event might well trigger other kinds of events in the oceans and atmospheres. And so it's at least possible that this particular extinction was triggered not by something from outside the planet, but something from inside the planet.
The process of extinction would normally begin because of major contamination. Meteorites or volcanoes would shake and move the Earth's surface, and as a result, chemical substances would be lifted from the Earth's crust into the atmosphere. Among these substances, carbon dioxide, the gas that is generated today when oil is burned, was very toxic due to its high concentrations, and few species were able to tolerate it. These clouds of dust and gas became so dense that they acted like the windows of a greenhouse. The Earth reheated, ice melted, and water cycles were modified. Hydrological regularity at that time was substituted by unexpected floods and fierce droughts. The plants suffered highly from such aggression. As time passed, there were fewer plants to absorb carbon dioxide and let off oxygen. This process is known as photosynthesis, which so many living beings depend on for breathing. Thus, little by little, contamination spread like an oil slick. The species could not defend themselves and couldn't survive. They didn't have enough time to try to adapt. After a major extinction, life was left in the hands of a few survivors. They marked the guidelines for the kind of species that would continue to inhabit the Earth. And as a consequence of such great biological catastrophes, the same forms of manifestations of life were never seen again.
The general pattern is that after a major extinction, there's a kind of vacuum, an ecological vacuum in the Earth, which is then filled by new evolutionary radiation, a new flowering of types. So, for example, before the dinosaurs went extinct, we had the dinosaurs filling all the major trades of life. There were carnivores and herbivores, large, medium and small, of both kinds. There were swimming animals, there were flying animals, there were burrowing animals, there were tree-climbing animals. They all went extinct. And then, in a rather short time, the mammals took their place, and they filled each of these separate trades, the carnivores, the herbivores, the large carnivores, medium and small, large herbivores, medium and small herbivores, the tree climbers, the burrowers, the flyers, the swimmers, and so on. So if you come back 20 million years after a major extinction, what you find is it's as though the same play is being performed on the stage, only the actors have changed.
There has not been a great extinction for over 65 million years. Without dinosaurs, without cataclysms, and due to milder climate conditions, the diversity of species has become what it is today. The human species developed during the last part of this long journey. Its appearance dates back about 100,000 years, a very small moment in time compared to the long history of the Earth. The condition for new species have not prevented human beings from dominating. There are barely any places left to conquer, or natural paradises in which man has not left his mark. Modification of natural habitats is not a modern invention, but a normal practice since human beings took their first step on Earth. Anthropological research is shattering the myth of the good savage spread by some 18th century philosophers. They defended man, asserting that he was naturally good, and contending that civilization made him a greedy and selfish being, distancing him from the natural environment with which he should have remained in close contact. But humans in perfect communion with the environment are an isolated case, more than a natural state. Most primitive communities have altered the ecological balance, even if they were unaware of the damage that they were causing nature. And even more important than the sacred vision of the forests and the animals, is the need to obtain immediate resources for subsistence, which has always prevailed.
When the first men reached America, for example, an enormous wave of extinctions of the larger species took place. These animals were more appetizing, easier to hunt, and provided the most proteins. Thus, once man arrived, in a few hundred years, about 1,000 years, a large number of species became extinct, especially the large mammals of North America and South America. This has also occurred in New Zealand and Madagascar, although mankind arrived much more recently. This happened 60 million years ago when man landed on Australia.
The human species, just like any other, tries to claim the most space possible for itself. But compared to other animals or plants, human beings have not been as restricted in their expansion. The possibilities to adapt to different climates and their creative abilities have allowed the human species to dominate other predators win many battles against deathly diseases, and develop broad technology for exploiting natural resources. The population has been able to grow with barely any external limitations. In 1999, there were 6 billion human beings. In 2025, there will be about 8 billion inhabitants. While the Earth remains the same size, the needs for space, energy, and food for human beings increases at the same fast pace as the population grows. Biodiversity suffers from the demands of the dominant species, which is now destroying natural habitats on a scale equal to its population and its technological capacity. For urban and agricultural purposes, or simply for exploiting the wealth of the region, all kinds of ecosystems are being stripped. The forest habitats are the most notable example. Every day, and all around the world, approximately 1.5 million trees are felled. Barely half of them are replaced, and when they are, the 100-year-old trees are substituted by very young ones, which are not capable of carrying out the same functions.
The forest is the most varied, complex, and qualified scope of land for providing basic elements. It is the most nourishing and where the most living species nourish. Without a doubt, it is the home to the largest number of species. More than half of all species on the planet live in the forest. And at least 70% of the vital multiplicity of the planet is aided by it. But above all, and at this time, the forest is considered more than ever to be the great solution. One of the great disasters of our world is the loss of soil. The forest creates soil and maintains it. And the forest right now could also be the best therapy for climate change, because they even act like a fixer. Not only for CO2, which we already know, but the forests fix noise pollution, they fix water pollution, and they fix soil pollution. Trees have also invented isolating control and reduction systems for the strongest contaminants, including the most aggressive heavy metals like mercury, lead, and cadmium. Right now, there isn't anything wiser than having the maximum number of trees in the world, because what they are doing is creating good living conditions. They are creating raw materials, and they are curing the worst environmental diseases.
Están proporcionando materias primas y están sanando, como creo que es bueno insistir, las peores enfermedades ambientales.
The habitats and their species do not only suffer from a direct attack, but also suffer the devastating effects on worldwide acts of contamination. The coral reefs are one of these victims. The reefs are the most exquisite creations of nature. Aside from their amazing beauty, they are capable of organizing life at the sea bottom, since more than 1/4 of all aquatic species depend on coral to survive. For human beings, they are considered enormous factories for medicines like AZT, which is used to counteract AIDS. Coral has existed for 500 million years. In such a short time, however, they are disappearing. The rise in temperatures due to the greenhouse effect, the pollution of the oceans and seas, and overfishing are placing the wide expanses of reef up against the ropes in the Indian and Pacific Ocean, as well as the Caribbean Sea. Today, they are disappearing at such speed that maybe in less than 50 years, there might not be a trace of them left.
The two big ones are the need to stabilize population and stabilize climate. If we can succeed with those two, then many of the other problems will take care of themselves. But if we don't succeed at those, then we may fail in many of the other efforts. For example, if we cannot stabilize population and if we cannot stabilize climate, there is not an ecosystem on Earth we can save. Everything will change. We can set land aside and call them parks or wildlife reserves and build fences around them, but if climate changes, the ecosystem will change. So there's a long list of stresses that are developing in the relationship between the global economy and the Earth's ecosystem. They include desertification, deforestation, overgrazing, overplowing, soil erosion, rising CO2 levels, rising temperature, more destructive storms, falling water tables, rivers running dry, disappearing species, dying coral reefs.
A strange phenomenon was detected 15 years ago among the amphibians around the world. The populations of frogs and toads are either disappearing or decreasing, even though they are different among each other and are located in remote territories. It seems like a worldwide plague, because there are no local reasons to justify the extinctions. Scientists are now beginning to understand the case. The decrease in the ozone layer, climate change due to the emission of contaminating gases, and the organic modification of the soil by fertilizers are the reality behind the global attack suffered by the amphibians.
The global average temperature that has changed in the last 100 years is only about a half a degree, 0.6 of a degree. This is a tiny change. So why are we concerned about it? Well, the reason we're concerned is because of the rate of the change. Geological changes have been much larger, but in most cases they have occurred much more slowly. And therefore organisms have been able to adjust to those changes. Imagine plants, forests. Now, at the end of the last ice age, when there was a global warming that took place over a period of around 10,000 years, Darwin noticed that what happened in Europe was that the flora and fauna of the ice age simply migrated in southern Europe to higher elevations and migrated northwards to northern Europe at low elevations. If they have 10,000 years, they don't have a problem. But if they only have 20 or 30 years, trees can't migrate that fast. Okay, so it's not the magnitude of global change that is a concern, it's the rate of the change.
In 1992, an algae of tropical origin, the Caulerpa taxifolia, reached the Spanish Mediterranean coasts. It has the ability to develop anywhere, but its fame is due to the danger it presents for many animal and plant species that are not tropical. The story of the Caulerpa taxifolia in the Mediterranean illustrated another threat that affects many autochthonous species, which are exterminated by the presence of foreign species. In 1982, the algae began to be cultivated at the aquarium in Monaco. Given its unique energy and ability to adapt, using it in the fish tanks was ideal. 2 years later, it was seen for the first time on the other side of the window at the famous aquarium. It probably passed through a drain pipe during cleaning. Thus, in 1984, it occupied 1 square meter of that Mediterranean zone. 6 years later, it was discovered 5 kilometers from the aquarium, and an exterminating trace could be followed through this entire section of the French coast. By the summer of the year 2000, the killer algae had already devastated enormous marine areas of Australia and had been discovered on the California coasts. Today in the Mediterranean, it occupies 7,000 hectares, which represents an astonishing growth in just a few years. And to date, the attempts to wipe it out have not been exactly positive.
Suddenly, there are organisms that reach a place where, for their happiness and for the misfortune of everyone else, they have ideal environmental conditions and lack the natural elements that control them in their place of origin. These elements control their explosive capacity, their tendency to dominate. And like a bull in a china shop, They override other plants or animals that were never prepared, from an evolutionary point of view, to fight against this imperialist capacity. I think this is a conclusion that really defines what happens to these organisms. They are imperialist living beings that want everything for them, and they also have the power to take over everyone else.
Some of the notable cases are the killer algae in the Mediterranean Sea, the rabbits in Australia, and the North American crabs in Spanish rivers. Most of the time, however, the extinctions due to a strange presence in the ecosystem are never registered, since their existence is unknown. An example is the case of this shrub on the small island of La Palma in the Canary Islands. Its disappearance is due to the introduction of goats and rabbits, herbivores foreign to this environment. Although the example of the Benchomia stipulata, the name of this plant, is not spectacular, its story proves that we're dealing with a worldwide phenomenon. Scientists are not exactly sure how many species are disappearing due to the destruction of their habitats, the effects of climatic change, and the introduction of foreign species into a habitat. The most accepted calculations are close to 27,000 species lost every year. It's a very high disappearance rate, and the extinctions are occurring faster than those that have shaken the Earth in the past.
These 27,000 lost species per year means that in 1,000 years, 27 million species would be lost, which means in 1,000 years, which is very little on the geological scale, practically all life on Earth would be lost. In this sense, every scientist is in agreement. There is no doubt about it. We are living in a time of major crisis, a major crisis of extinctions, meaning that species are becoming extinct so quickly or faster than during other periods of the Earth's history in which species became quickly extinct. For example, at the time when the dinosaurs disappeared, this was something that occurred suddenly. On the geological scale, it occurred suddenly, which means hundreds of thousands of years, even a million years, which is what the dinosaurs took to completely disappear.
A constellation of satellites watches over the well-being of the Earth. Thanks to them, we have a more precise understanding of how the hole in the ozone layer is growing and how much forest is lost every year. In March of 2002, the European Space Agency placed Envisat, the best-equipped spacecraft of our time, into orbit. Placed at 800 kilometers away from the Earth's surface, it's able to completely examine the planet in only 3 days. The Envisat has high-power antennas and all classes of detection systems, which allows it to analyze the short and medium-term consequences of fires, of industrial pollution, of global warming, and of volcanic eruptions. Because of its enormous versatility, and because of the extremely valuable information that it provides, scientists now have a tool with which they will be able to predict the future of every ecosystem on our planet, with barely any margin of error. The more precise the X-rays of the Earth are, the benefits of an ecosystem working at full capacity or the dangers of destruction will be better understood. So that public opinion becomes conscious of the importance of a healthy state of nature, some scientists are trying to assign economic values to things, like clean air, which until recently did not appear to have any value at all. In a general approximation, researchers have estimated that nature will produce consumer goods every year that are double the gross domestic product of all the countries on Earth. Along with all the kinds of natural resources used for different purposes, like wood and water. Other resources included in these calculations are the oxygen produced by plants and trees, and the absorption of CO2 that affects the oceans and forests. Furthermore, the vast amount of medicines and animal proteins that nature offers human beings are also taken into account.
In the summer of 1998, there was severe flooding, record or near record flooding, in the Yangtze River Basin in China. It lasted for weeks. And at first, the Chinese, in fact, for some weeks, the Chinese said, well, this is an act of nature. But the reality was the rainfall was not anywhere near a record. What was the record was the amount of deforestation in the Yangtze River Basin. At that time, they had lost 85% of all the original tree cover in the Yangtze River Basin, where 400 million people live. And so when the rains came down, there just wasn't much to hold the rainfall anymore. So it was just flooding. And then in mid-August, after several weeks of this, the Chinese leadership held a press conference. And they said, we have concluded that environmental factors, like deforestation, are contributing to this. We are imposing a ban on all tree cutting in the Yangtze River Basin because, they said, trees standing are worth three times as much as trees cut.
Biodiversity is not evenly distributed throughout the land and sea, but a large part is concentrated in a relatively small number of habitats scattered around the globe, but with a clear dominance in the tropical areas. Thus, it is estimated that more than a third of the known plants and land vertebrates are confined to areas that cover less than 2% of the globe's surface. These places are known as hotpoints of high diversity. In a way, they are large shelters and reserves of nature. Its current critical state has made scientists and naturalists place them on the first line of battle for environmental preservation. Rescuing them and preserving them should be, at least, the necessary condition for a global strategy in defense of biodiversity, although it really is not enough.
I think it's a useful tool for organizing efforts to protect biological diversity. One of my concerns is if we rely on it too heavily and don't deal with the causal factors, like population growth, like climate change, that in the end we may not succeed. For example, there are places in Africa where efforts are made to set aside parks and preserves. But if population continues to grow and people get hungry or their cattle are starving, it's almost impossible to keep them from invading these preserves. In fact, they're doing that now. You can't just shoot people because they want to survive, in a sense. So, unless we deal with population growth, which is the driving force here, then putting fences around things in Africa and calling them parks or wildlife preserves probably will not work in the end.
Costa Rica is one of these privileged places of biodiversity. In barely 51,000 square kilometers, 5% of all species living on Earth are found. Costa Rica also represents a ray of hope. Before it was too late, the Costa Rican government stopped the destruction of the natural environment and created a broad network of national parks. In fact, today it is the country with the most protected soil in the world, which accounts for 25% of its territory. In Costa Rica, however, the major difference lies in the fact that the local populations have become involved in the preservation and research of these lands. Thanks to the programs of the National Institute of Biodiversity, the inhabitants of the towns work to collect species that are later investigated and cataloged by scientists around the world. Many of these scientists work for the pharmaceutical industries. The lesson learned from places like Costa Rica is obvious and conclusive for naturalists. Living off the forest does not mean destroying it, because wood is just one of the hundreds of renewable resources that the forest provides. Whales, panda bears, rhinoceroses, the Asian elephant, and the American puma are some species that are unfortunately famous. The danger of their extinction has turned them into the most popular campaign device used to defend the environment. These animals, however, are doomed to become extinct, and there's no solution. And just like them, thousands of unknown species have no space to live because of mankind. But when a species imposes its dominance at the expense of exterminating others, life, sooner or later, will end up suffering a serious backward step. We are the only species able to realize what we are doing. We are also the only species that has a weapon like scientific knowledge to fight destructive ignorance. Everything else depends on whether we are willing to come to terms with what is at stake and recognize who the real losers are.
Well, we more or less stand at a crossroads now, and what we do in the next 5 to 10 years will determine what the planet looks like 100 years from now. If we take one road, which is the road of neglect, it is very likely that diversity will be severely eroded over the next 100 years. So if we do nothing, we will have much less rainforest, much less in the way of large animal diversity, much more in the way of prominence of those organisms that do well with where people are, foxes, rats, things like that, cockroaches. On the other hand, we do have the capacity to live a life of stewardship, if you will, that will ensure that your grandchildren and my grandchildren will still be able to see elephants and rhinoceros in Africa, that there will still be substantial amounts of rainforest in South America.
We are the first generation whose actions can quite literally shape the world in which future generations will live. No generation before us has had the capacity to alter the Earth's climate, to cause the sixth great extinction. All the earlier extinctions going back over hundreds of millions of years were caused when a huge meteor collided with the Earth or something of that sort. But here, it's not a meteor colliding with the Earth, it's us and our demands colliding with the capacity of the Earth to satisfy those demands.